good afternoon. Pleasure for me to introduce Dean of the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences, Professor Fotis, Sotiropoulos.
Very good.
There are some people here that came to see if I could pronounce your name at all close.
And as you could see, all it is to get some momentum.
Yes.
Because the moment you start it, it goes straight after
right.
that. Yeah, thank you.
And I want you to note the picture. This is when Fotis went out with us last summer on the Sea Wolf, and I think we all had an exciting day. And as you can see, he's gotten to touch one of the little sand sharks, I call it. That's not quite right, is it, Janet?
Dogfish.
It's a dogfish.
Oh, come on, don't dignify it.
So, Fotis comes to us from the University of Minnesota, where he was in the College of Civil Engineering as well as Mechanical Engineering. But he got his degrees from his PhD from the University of Cincinnati. And he then got his master's degree before that at Penn State University. And he was trained initially in Greece at the National Technical University of Athens. He assumed his duties as the dean of the school here in 2015. And as many of you know, the School of Marine Atmospheric Sciences has very close ties to the School of Engineering. And in fact, I've mentioned earlier today, was due to largely the physical oceanography people here that convinced the president that we should have a program in civil engineering. And since that time, we have worked very closely with the entire school, including having some joint faculty members. In addition to that, we have the Clean Water Center. We have been trying to develop a couple of joint proposals, and I think we're getting together again on Monday morning to discuss yet another one. So it's a great pleasure to have Fotis here. I think this is the first time in my memory that we've actually had a dean of one of our other schools come here to give a talk. So Fotis, it's a pleasure, and thank you for coming.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and thank you for giving me the opportunity. Let's see, is this, yeah, I think we're good to go. Great. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here. I have to say that this started a while back when David Conover sent an email to me once. As soon as I came to Stony Brook, we had published some work on shark skin hydrodynamics, and then he saw this and he said, oh, you have to come to SoMAS and give a seminar, right? So, but then time passed, many things happened, so finally I'm glad we're able to schedule it. So, since I had promised this to David that I will speak about the work we have done on fish-like swimming, that will be the biggest part of my talk. But I also want to highlight toward the end, in passing, some of the other areas we're working with computational methods. And these are some of the areas that I think are very appropriate for joint collaborations with SoMAS. I think there are a lot of opportunities. So the first part of my talk will be on the work we have done on hydrodynamics of fish-like swimming. The second part over the end, I'll highlight a little bit on our work on simulating turbulence in rivers, sediment transport, tidal energy applications, and so on. And I think you'll see a lot of the opportunities for joint collaboration. So the title of my talk is Insights Gained by Numerical Simulations, because the work that I have done is all numerical. It's building computational models, developing brand new computational models that are able to do very complicated settings, like simulate something that swims, flies with all its anatomic features, for instance, simulate turbulence in real life aquatic environments with complex flow structure interaction problems, and use these computational models as the tools for scientific discovery. Okay, our work has not been just, okay, let's write a code to simulate something, get some results, compare, and go home, but it has been really trying to use simulation as a tool of scientific discovery, find new physics, things that cannot be extracted from experiments alone. And I think this area of fish-like swimming is a great area to demonstrate this. So The fundamental question that has kind of governed our work in this field, and that goes back now over a decade of work that I will briefly summarize, is this: whether hydrodynamics has played a role in the evolution of fish body shapes and swimming styles in nature. And this is, of course, you're dealing with fish that have evolved over millennia and millions of years and so on. So these questions are very hard to answer, but computation, numerical simulation, gives us an opportunity to do experiments that are impossible to do in nature, right? Because we can do anything we want with this numerical fish, okay? And you'll see what we try to do here. I have to say, this is, we have been fortunate throughout the years to have our work on a number of covers of different journals, but this is the one that I'm the most proud of, because we're able to get on the journal on the cover of Experimental Biology with a computational image. So that was, and it shows really the wake structures that are created when an eel is swimming, these vortex loops. And so a big thing of our work, and that will be the only slide I use about numerical methods. As I said, a big part of my work is to develop computational algorithms that can do very complicated problems. And we have developed this method based on immersed boundary technique, which allows us to do fluid structural interaction in arbitrarily complex geometries. I've worked on simulating swimming from fish, for plankton, using three-dimensional reconstructions of complete anatomic anatomies of the actual animals. I've done a lot of work on blood flow in the heart, interaction of cardiovascular flows with heart valves in the left heart and so on, and a lot of computational work in natural flows, environmental fluid mechanics types of flows, rivers, ocean waves interacting with structures and so on. All these are arbitrarily complex flows that require this type of ability to simulate with very high resolution, very complex flows. So the our work, for anybody who is interested in the numerical details, it has been published in a series of papers in the Journal of Computational Physics over a decade, the fundamental numerical infrastructure that goes into our code. But the bottom line is we do not adapt the grids to the body shape. We use this immersed boundary setting, and I don't want to have, I have a lot of ground to cover. If anybody is interested in the numerics, I'll be glad to provide these details. But the bottom line is the work that I will show you is all done with codes we have developed, and they use this numerical infrastructure that allow you to do very complicated problems in a very efficient way. So to demonstrate, for instance, the very thing I would like, the very first thing I would like to highlight, and again, as I said, it was where I have to leave out to the picture that there, even though it is not a shark, but I have to say I have touched an actual shark. That was in Belize. This was these warm water sharks that we went out on a cruise, and this guy is throwing fish from the boat, and all the sharks come around, and then he says, okay, now dive and play with the sharks. And I said, you die first. So he did it, and these were very friendly sharks. So this was, it was quite impressive. And this is it. So anyway, so I want to highlight the ability that we have to simulate really complicated geometries, that you cannot do them with traditional methods. So I think in this audience, you appreciate the issues with shark skin denticles, you know, they have evolved over millions and millions of years, and you have this very complicated microstructure that it has been hypothesized that somehow it is there to minimize drag and allow sharks to swim very fast, right? In fact, because of this, we have engineered structures like these riblets, right, that are supposed to be inspired from shark skin, which are used on airplanes, they're used on ships and wind turbine blades, and indeed, actually, they're very capable of reducing drag. So this is a 3M micro riblet. So in this case, the flow would be coming perpendicular to the plane in the riblet structure, right? So what we did, we worked with George Lauder's group, who has been doing a lot of work at Harvard with actual shark skin. We're able to reconstruct individual denticles, and then we did the first sort of numerical experiment of its kind. Let's take a flat plate, simulate the turbulent flow. This is with direct numerical simulation, resolving all the scales of turbulence, no turbulence model here. Very expensive simulations on massively parallel supercomputers. And then let's put riblets on the same flat plate, and let's put shark denticles. Okay, so we can actually compare now in a simple engineer system of what happens. So we have beds of denticles like this, which were different arrangements aligned or staggered, and there is a lot, we were able to get a wealth of information. You see here some representative results. These are time average results. After you simulate the turbulent flow, you time average, you get the streamwise vorticity that shows how these sets of streamwise vortices develop along the denticles and so on. And we learned a lot about how denticles behave and how they behave relative to riblets. But I think the take-home message that I would like to bring here, which is essentially the most important finding of this work, is this. So what we are plotting here is this S plus is the size of the riblets or the denticle. So essentially it would be the height of the riblets or the height of the denticle here. But it is scaled with a length scale which is characteristic of the viscous sublayer, right? Because these things operate inside the viscous sublayer. So there is a length scale that depends on the viscosity of the fluid and the shear velocity. It turns out that riblets are known to reduce drag in that range, when S plus is in the range of 10 to 20, the optimal performance is between 10 to 20, actually. If the riblets, if they become too big, they stick out outside of the viscous part of the boundary layer, and they become big obstacles, right? If they have to be at the right, just the right size to reduce the drag. And this is experimental data in the literature, what you see here first, these points here, these continuous lines. One thing I want to highlight, this is the baseline. So this is the force, the total force, versus the force of the flat plate. So we divide the net force, the drag force basically, divided by the force of the flat plate. So if you put riblets on a flat plate, what happens? You are reducing the drag, and you can see this here. But if you put actual shark skin, these are some pioneering experiments by Bessert and his group, where it showed significant drag increase. But then there were other experiments later from Lauder's group at Harvard that showed there was the drag, the shark was reducing the hydrodynamic drag. So our simulations, what they show is that these are the three points. These are three simulations. For the riblets, we get a drag reduction very much along with the experimental data. And for aligned and staggered denticle arrangements, we actually get a significant increase in line with experimental data. Our angle was different of the, that's why we are not exactly there, but we had somewhat a higher angle. The bottom line is we found that shark skin, at least for this controlled engineering system, actually increases drag. And we're able to explain why, because this, unlike riblets that create these very nice organized aligned straight vortices, sharks' denticles are very three-dimensional. They create separation. A lot of this drag is form drag because of separation from the denticle surface. They increase the turbulent stresses near the shark skin and so on. So the bottom line here is the debate is still on. The jury is still out on this. But we have, for the first time ever, a numerical simulation for a well-defined engineer system with very high numerical resolution, resolving all the scales of turbulence that we find this. Of course, questions like what is the effect of the flexibility of the shark body cannot be answered. These are, to address these questions actually on an actual shark would require an order of magnitude increase in computational capability to do it at this level that we can do it right now. But nevertheless, I think we were able to provide some new insights there that are supporting a series of previous experiments. But having said this, some more recent experiments show something different. But there are uncertainties about these experiments, which we were trying to figure out and so on. But this is one example of the types of things you can do with these simulations. Now, so this was very recent work. It was published last year. I will review for you now work that we have done over the last 10 years in this hydrodynamics of fish-like swimming. And those of you who deal with fish may know this pioneering work by the Triantafilou brothers from MIT. A lot of Greeks work with fish, apparently. I mean, I don't know. It's like we like them fried and grilled also. But anyway, where they had looked at different types of species, so this important parameter, the Strouhal number, which is really the frequency, it's a non-dimensional frequency, it's the frequency that the fish beats its tail, based on a characteristic time scale that depends on the amplitude at which the tail moves and the velocity of the swimming, right? So this is the Strouhal number. And they found that all the fish really in nature that they looked at swim in this range of Strouhal numbers, between 0.25, 0.35. And they deduced from that actually this is the optimal Strouhal number. The fish somehow optimized it. And there was a lot of work that was done on this and so on. But about 10 years later, There was this very interesting work that was done by George Lauder and his student and at the time, and Eric Tytel, where they looked at data for Pacific salmon, juvenile Pacific salmon. And they actually plotted here the Struhal number at which they swim, this dimensional parameter, versus the speed at which they swim. And they find a very weird trend. So essentially they find that the slower the salmon swims, actually the higher the Struhal number, far outside this optimal range, okay? So that created the question, do fishers at least, do these Pacific salmon guys choose to swim inefficiently at low speeds, or what is going on really, okay? Is there anything that has been optimized or not? So how do you address this question? In order to be able to address a question like that, you would have to design an experiment in which you could independently vary the Struhal number, okay, and the essentially vary the tailbeat frequency of the fish and the swimming speed. You cannot really do this with live fish. You can, fish will put them in a, they'll swim at whatever they feel like they swim, right? So that's where virtual fish become handy, because in, you can design numerical experiments that can actually take care of this. So what we did is we considered two different types of species, a carangiform and anguilliform type of swimming. We parameterized the motion with a particular equation. These are here the motion of the body of the fish, actually. So there's a wave that is prescribed here. The tail bit amplitude scaled with the length of the fish. The Struhal number that I told you, right? The frequency at which the tail beats relative to a characteristic frequency that depends on the swimming speed and the tail bit amplitude. The Reynolds number, right? Very important, the importance of viscous versus inertial terms. This is the length of the fish and the swimming speed and the viscosity of the fluid. The slip velocity, which is the ratio of the swimming speed versus the speed at which the undulation wave propagates along the body of the fish. All these are important parameters, and we've looked at all of this in many different ways, but I'll just highlight few important things here. So we looked at Reynolds numbers essentially going from laminar to transitional to infinite, like looking at implicit calculations at full-scale Reynolds numbers. So this is our swimmers. In fact, I had earlier, I was still at Georgia Tech when we did this work. I had this student who actually the lamprey, we got it from a lab at Princeton, the geometry. But the mackerel, actually, I had the student got the frozen mackerel, chopped it up, and they measured the cross sections, and we reconstructed them. He would come to me with his notes, and they stunk really to high heaven for a long time. But that's what it took. So it's a brilliant undergraduate at Georgia Tech who gave us this model. So we have the mackerel and we have the lamprey, and we can do simulations that, for instance, can produce things like that, right? So you have here, what you see here is the three-dimensional structure of the vortex loops that are shed from the fish body when it swims in one particular way. Okay, so one thing that you see here is there is a wake where you get vortex loops that are split in two rows, right? What is interesting here is that for the most part, wakes like this had been observed in experiments only for eels, not for mackerels, but we're able to explain why this had not been observed, and it had to do with the frequency at which the fish beats its tail. It turns out that the structure of the wake depends a great deal on the Struhal number and not so much on the body shape or the kinematics, okay? So anyway, so what we wanted to do is really to try to address this question, why does this juvenile salmon at low speeds tends to beat its tail at much higher frequency? So we designed this fish on a stick experiment, is what I call it, right? This is the only way that we can control independently the Struhal number and the Reynolds number. So in order to control the Reynolds number, you have the viscosity of the fluid, which is fixed. You have the length of the fish, which is whatever it is. But then you have the velocity u, right? So let's say you attach the fish on a tether, and you move that tether at constant speed, whatever you want that speed to be. And then you make your numerical fish beat its tail across a range of frequencies. So you can fix u by fixing the Reynolds number, and then you make the fish actually beat its tail at whatever speed you would like it to be. So now you can look at one particular Reynolds number, what happens as you vary the Struhal number. Can never do this experiment in nature, right, with a live fish. But you can do it perhaps with a robotic fish, but not with a live fish. So what happens is, as this happens, in general, you would have a drag force. You create a thrust because you impose a thrust to move this forward. And then there is a net force on the tether, right, which is going to be the difference between thrust and drag force. So at any given time, you may have a net thrust force or a net drag force. But what we are really looking is for a fixed Reynolds number or for a fixed speed to find the Strouhal number at which this force becomes zero. Because at that limit, if I cut the tether, this fish will continue moving at constant speed, right? It will be able to self-propel itself. So computationally, we can do this. And when we do this for different Reynolds numbers, we have Strouhal number here. We have the force coefficient, which is the net force, right? So the net force zero. Zero is the time, is the self-propelled limit. So be above this, you have a net thrust that would accelerate the fish. Below this, you have a net drag that would actually not allow the fish to self-propel at this speed. And also here, for a point of comparison, we have the rigid body. What would be if I towed the same rigid body, the same fish, but as a rigid body at the same speed? Okay, that's very important because there's a lot of interesting things, whether undulations increase the drag of a rigid body or reduce it and so on. I don't have time to get into all of this, but the point here is the following. So we have three Reynolds numbers, three swimming speeds here, right? Very low speed, low Reynolds number, high viscous effects, intermediate, and very high the inviscid limit. And one thing you can see here is that the Strouhal number for each swimming speed, basically what happens in a given viscous environment, the fish begins to move its tail. Initially, it cannot go forward, but there's going to be a particular tail bit frequency that will provide enough thrust to self-propel, all right? And that's the limit. And the point here is that as you increase the Reynolds number, as you go to higher and higher speeds, the Strouhal number becomes less. And as a matter of fact, it turns out that for this inviscid limit, we find the Strouhal number to be exactly at where the experiments in Nature said that all these fish optimize the swimming. The key thing was that all the swimmers that the Triandafilou brothers looked at were fast swimmers. These were salmon, tuna. It was things that are moving really fast. So they were looking really in this range of Reynolds numbers. Nobody had looked in this range of Reynolds numbers, where juvenile salmon, having smaller body in a given fluid environment, they swam in a much smaller Reynolds number environment. Therefore, they were more on this side of things. So the conclusion from this is that for each Reynolds number, there's a unique Strouhal number at which constant speed swimming is possible. The Strouhal number decreases with increasing Reynolds number. And of course, Pacific salmon is not selecting to swim inefficiently. It is just doing it the best it can in a given viscous environment it finds itself, okay? Which depends on the viscosity of the fluid, which is fixed, and the size of its body, basically, which would change at different ages and so on. So what about the issue of efficiency, all right? So we could compute the efficiency because we have all the forces. So we have the thrust force times the velocity. That's the useful power. And then you have the additional, you have the propulsive power plus the side, all the power that goes from the body undulations into the body. That's the thing. And I don't want to get into the details, but because we have everything we need to know. We have the pressures, we have the shear velocities, everything on the fish at every instant in time through the simulations, right? So we could compute this and calculate the efficiency. And what we find is that the efficiency actually for Carangi for swimmers is optimized at the high Reynolds number limit. So this type of motion, Carangi for motion, works well for very high for fast swimmers. Okay, if you do exactly the same analysis for anguilliform swimmers, what you're going to find is that first of all, the efficiency, I mean, there is of course the same thing that you cross zero at a given Strouhal number, but for anguilliform swimmers, the efficiency seems to be optimized somewhere in the middle range of Reynolds numbers, because actually eels and swim at actually this intermediate range, this transitional range, so they are not in the high Reynolds number range, okay? So very, very consistent results really with what were observed in Nature. So some conclusions then from these types of simulations. For each Reynolds number, there's a unique Strouhal number that self-propelled swimming is possible. The Strouhal number where this happens decreases as Reynolds number increases. The body undulations, well, these are things I didn't show you results, but we're able to get a lot more information, like the body undulations tend to decrease. There was a big discussion in the literature, do body undulations decrease or increase drag? And it turns out that depends which drag you're talking about, the form drag versus the viscous drag and so on. Anguilliform swimming is more efficient in the transitional regime, but Carangi for swimming is more efficient in the inertial regime, which is actually where this... So there is some first clear connections that perhaps evolutionary, these swimming styles have evolved for this particular fluid environment that they were designed to actually operate, that they try to operate. We also found very interestingly that anguilliform swimmers require less power than Karanti for swimming and so on. So so there's a lot of interesting information that came out of these unique experiments. But remember, these were all experiments on a fish on a stick, okay? So now we can do better than this. And in fact, there was a quite intriguing statement that, again, by George Lauder's group, looking at the structure of wakes, and where they made the statement, if a mackerel, for example, swam using the same kinematics as an eel, its wake would probably differ from that of an eel due to differences in body shape. So Lauder and Tytel said, you know what, the body makes a big difference here. So because they did a lot of great experiments with lasers, they looked at the wake structures. But to me, I found this quite intriguing because I said, you know what, they cannot do this in the lab, but computationally we can do this. What if a mackerel swam like an eel? Right? What if we can actually do this. We can take a mackerel and impose to it eel kinematics and vice versa. So we did this, and we got into, so this is, we created this matrix of genetically modified fish, right? So this is a mackerel swimming like an eel. This is a mackerel swimming as it is actually supposed to be swimming. And you see an eel actually beating its, so we can impose these different kinematics there. And there's a lot of stuff that we found out. There's a series of papers in the Journal of Experimental Biology that we discussed all this. But I think the most fun thing was we could do races. So we could get off to the races, right? So, but to do this, we had to develop this new capability in the code. The previous simulations, it was fish on a stick, where we drag the fish through the water, right? Now, we prescribed just the motion, and we developed this flow structural interaction capability where the fish was able to determine its own propulsive speed, all right? So we could computationally, it would be the equivalent thing of placing a fish in a water tank. The fish starts beating its tail at the whatever decided to do, and then see what happens. Will it accelerate? How fast it will go? What is the steady swimming speed it will achieve, and so on. So we didn't make any assumption about swimming speed here. We couldn't vary independently the Reynolds number and the Struhal number here, right? We just prescribed the Struhal number, the tail beat frequency, the tail beat frequency, and we let the thing involved. And we prescribed the viscosity, so the Reynolds number was also. But we had to do this we had to develop this capability, another kind of level of computational complexity, and so on. So here is what happens. These are now, I'll show you the results of fish races, okay? So we could actually get an eel, a lamprey here, race against its alter ego, its mackerel lamprey, right? In the same viscous environment, all right? So the Reynolds number for both was about 4,000, okay, for both. We could do the same thing for the mackerel. And let's see. So see what happens. They start exactly the same. The only difference here is the body kinematics. And it's kind of interesting initially, but you can see that in this Reynolds number, actually, the lamprey is able to overtake its alter ego very easily, actually, and win that race, okay? Which you may say it's not surprising because that's what eels are supposed to do. But now you can go into the mackerel, and you can actually see here that the alter ego of the mackerel actually is doing very, very easily wins that race, okay? And of course, because these are full simulations, we know everything about the flow. I'm not showing you all the details, but we can compute forces, pressure fields, everything. So the conclusion really that emerged here is that to go fast in the transitional regime, you need to swim like an eel, even if you're a mackerel, actually. And there are a lot of explanations about this when you begin to analyze what you find there. So now we can do the same experiment in the range of very low viscous environment, right? Range of infinite Reynolds number. So look what happened. Oops. Oh, okay. I thought it's going to play. So I have to click. So look what happens here. This is very interesting. It's very, very interesting. At the beginning, place your bets. You think that the lamprey is going to lose, but no. Look at the mackerel lamprey coming way from behind and winning that race by a large margin. Okay. So same thing happens with mackerel. The anguilliform guy is trying initially, but then it just left behind. Okay. The conclusion here is that in the inertial regime, high swimming speeds really, If you need to swim, you need to swim like a mackerel if you are an eel, if you really want to go fast. Now, you can ask questions how much energy you're spending, what's the efficiency, these are all separate. But if speed is what you really want to optimize, that's what you need to do. So, but you will have a hard time starting, and you saw that. Which actually would bring me to the next topic, because you see, fish really want a fast start, they never start by doing that. They use the C-start maneuver, and you'll see a little bit about this. So, if you wanted to start beating your tail, and you want to avoid the predator, or get some food that is nearby, and make a fast maneuver, that's not going to work, obviously, so you have to do something else. So, the conclusions was that to be efficient in the transitional regime, you need an anguilliform body and kinematics. In the inertial regime, you need a carangiform body kinematics. To go fast in general, you need the body of the mackerel, the swimming speed. Actually, mackerel tends to use less power. You need the body of the lamprey. I didn't show the results for all this, but this is the data that conclusions from our data. Wake structure primarily depends on the Strouhal number and not the body shape of or kinematics. And being able to clearly answer the louder question, if a mackerel swam like an eel, its wake structure would be exactly the same as the eels if both swam at the same Strouhal number. But they don't, because they swim in different environments, so you can never see that, okay? So I'll move to the next example, which again, we started, this was about the time that we started working very closely with George Lauder when we showed him some of the computational results, and he got really excited, and he has all these experimental capabilities. So at about 2010, he was working on this great sea start of bluegill sunfish. So they have developed this PIV system, particle image velocimetry. They spend a lot of time trying to get the fish to turn, stimulating it to do this kind of stuff, and then measuring the flow velocity. So this is measurements. You see the fish starts from this location. It performs this very fast kick with its tail and ejects at 90 degrees in a different direction. Biologically, extremely important maneuver, because the guys who were able to do this, they survived to tell about it, right? So those who couldn't do this, they couldn't escape danger as easily or whatever. So Lauder gave us, they had high digital cameras, they were able to get high resolution images to allow us to reconstruct essentially the body of their the bluegill sunfish and the kinematics. So we actually created, we were able to do this, and now we could simulate the flow with this prescribed kinematics, and first of all, perform the first ever comparison of flow measured with particle image velocimetry or with anything and a computational model. Because now we could actually compare the flow. This was an experiment which, it's a simulation that's informed with data for which there was real experimental measurement. So we could do this. We could actually put the PIV fish and the actual numerical fish here. You see, it's about 70 milliseconds that the whole maneuver takes to complete. So as you go through the turn, you begin to see that in the experiments there's this clear vortex that develops in the tail. You see a jet that is directed toward the body of the fish here. You see another smaller eddy here. We begin to get very similar things. These large velocities, by the way, that you see are very close to the body, which are not resolved by PIV. So this is not a mistake, but it's just that we have points much, much closer to the body than the experiment can resolve. And they are very, as the body moves, these velocities become very, very large. But they don't have data in this area. So the maneuver is completing. Look at the structure of the jet. Okay, it's pretty much essentially very, very similar. Even here, we get this flow directed this way. I should say that a big thing in the PIV experiment, the fish never stayed exactly on one plane, which we had assumed. So it was extremely difficult. They had to do several experiments to get this right. So to precisely match the kinematics was not possible. And I think small differences are because of subtle difference in the kinematics. And of course, as the maneuver is completed, you have this full developed wake structure with a triple jet, okay? So look at this jet right here, this big eddy here creating thrust in this direction that will propel the fish forward. Then you have the tail jet that is creating a strong component this way, and you have a third jet pushing the body to turn, basically, right? So essentially, we were able to capture everything that they saw in the experiment. I'm not going to show you, but we were able to compare with the forces, and we had a paper in the Journal of Experimental Biology that described all this, were able to explain some issues, some difficulties they had with the experiment. But what was really the coolest thing is to see the three-dimensional structure of the loops, the vortex loops that are associated with this maneuver, right? And these jets that you saw in one 2D plane, they are three-dimensional vortex loops. And that's what you see here, actually. You see this beautiful vortex ring, and you see this multiple kind of vortex loops that are set from the tail that, when you cut them with a slice, create this triple jet structure that you saw in the experiment, right? So where we are today, we actually just started this work with my colleague and collaborator Alex Tessé from MIT. She has been working on the jumping of archer fish. So this guy here, this is the video from Alex's lab at MIT. This guy is able to really jump. I mean, speaking of jumping, consider, look at how many body lengths it's able to, what a powerful stride, getting out of the water, right? Now, we have a new code right now, which we developed to simulate waves interacting with wind turbines, which can do both air and water, right? So we are actually working right now to actually simulate this experiment. That's a much more challenging thing. So we have already set up the kinematics. This is the reconstruction of the kinematics as the fish is jumping out. And we are in the process, hopefully in the next seminar, a year from now, maybe I can show you some of these results. But notice initially the pectoral fish strike, big push backward really with the pectoral fish, and then it's moving its tail. Look, it gets one stroke with the pectoral fish, gets out of the water, and then moves the tail to go up. So we can now, we hope with these simulations, we'll be able to really see how much thrust is produced at every stage and really figure out how this thing is able to do this, right? So. So this is kind of concludes the part of my talk about fish swimming. I hope I gave you a brief but fairly complete introduction of what we're doing. I want to move to the last part of my talk, where I want to highlight to you some of the work we have been doing more recently, which is really focusing on developing computational tools for simulating turbulence in natural river environments, ocean environments, and so on. Our work in this field has been motivated by a range of sustainability challenges at this intersection of water, energy, and climate. Strip back erosion, flash flooding, collapse of bridges, impacts of megastorms, and so on, but also the need to extract energy, whether it is from tides or offshore wind farms, and so on. So we have been developing computational tools that really allow us to simulate turbulent flows in real-life environments by actually using data to reconstruct natural aquatic environments like this, flow structure interaction to really look at how turbines interact with flows, algorithms to simulate sediment transport and dunes migrating through rivers during flooding events, and so on. So I just show you some examples in just primarily to illustrate the capabilities, the code we have developed, and then again, it's based on the same methodology that we use to do the fish code, actually. It has evolved to do turbulent flows and so on. The code is available as open source right now. But so I'll show you a couple of examples. Again, I don't have time to go through the physics. We found a lot of exciting physics through this that led experimentalists to go back and check and be able to confirm them. But I just want to illustrate capability. So a recent piece of work, Alijo Sonajad was with me at St. Anthony Falls for a number of years and led a lot of this work. And now he's faculty in civil engineering here, bringing a lot of the capabilities here at Stony Brook. So we focused on, this is a small creek in Minnesota, Eagle Creek, which actually we had made it into kind of a field scale laboratory, very complicated environment with tree trunks fallen, big boulders, and so on. So we had students spend an entire summer surveying the creek. We got bathymetry data. We got the precise location of all the fallen wood in there. The objective here is what happens to scalar transport, like nutrient processing, for instance, these streams. The residence time of scalars is very, very important, right? So when you have fertilizers or any pollutant or whatever, how long it takes before it washes out. It is really important to understand the interaction of turbulence with the topography. And without actually having this, all these details, because these areas where the wood, for instance, creates recirculating regions where
traces, scalars could be trapped for a very long time. There's no other way to do this without this level of simulation, right? So we created this full three-dimensional model. It's about 300 meters, this stream. So this is the result of a simulation. This is a full 3D, unsteady, large eddy simulation. What I will show you here is a pulse release. I'll show you the visualization of this tracer of the solute that was released here at the inlet, and you see what happens as it goes, as it is advected by the flow through. So you see the ability of the, this is really very fine simulations of turbulent structures and so on. You see very complicated vortex setting and so on. One thing that it is evident here is that how long this one single pulse release stays into this system, right? And because you see, it takes, in fact, the video, it will stop because I have to move on, but you have to run the simulation for a very long time. Ultimately, everything clears out, but it takes a long time, and you can see areas where things have been trapped for a very long time, and slowly, as turbulence shear layers are created, look at this, they are able to transport material from there and eventually exit. What we had done, this was accompanied with a field experiment in which saline water was injected in the stream. So we had measurements of the arrival of the concentration form here at the inlet and one point here, and you can actually see here the comparison of concentration between, so this is the time, starting from 0 to 1500 seconds. Blue is actually what happens here, the measurement, the sensor here, and red is here. You see the comparisons between the experiments and the simulation. So especially the red is very encouraging because the red has the memory of everything that has happened in the stream. So we can use data, set up these types of simulations, and also predict with this accuracy physical processes in there. Now, another example, this simulation that I show you had a rigid bed. During flooding, you get big dunes that are forming, right? So you get a lot of sediment transported. We have developed a code that allows us actually to simulate the transport of the formation of dunes, dune migration, interaction of sediment beds with the flow. So I show you one quick example here. This is an experiment that we used as we wanted to validate the code. This is a laboratory flume. You see from the top, turbulent flow, sand bed, you saw the flow started, transverse dunes appeared. We chose this experiment because they had a wealth of data that we could compare our simulations, right? And I don't have time to show you the details, but we have published this work in a fairly detailed paper in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics a couple of years ago. So this is an example of the simulation. So this is just a slice through the channel. You see the bed initially flat. This is a simulation where there is fully coupled dynamics of the bed load, layer sediment, sediment in suspension with the flow. So you saw how the dunes began to appear, and you see these are instantaneous velocities. You see very complicated turbulent structures, and this is the concentration of suspended sediment as the dunes develop, and you can see that as these dunes form big and big sediment masses come into suspension and so on. So a real cool video is this one, which kind of now tries to replicate what they saw in the experiment. This is the bed elevation. So we start from a flat bed, and you're going to see now how these bed forms develop. There are different stages of formation that we're able to analyze. We're able to explain how turbulence creates the initial bed instability. You see fully transverse dunes forming here, very complicated shapes actually forming here, which they had seen in the experiments as well. And in a way, if you look at this, you can see a 6 centimeter mountain range with a little lake forming, you know, in the mega floods period at much bigger scales when huge volumes of sediments move on the surface of the earth. Similar features like that are there, right? Of course, we see them here in a small scale. So this is just an example of the topologies of connections that they saw in the lab and so on. But we were able to predict the amplitude, the speeds, and everything that they had seen in the laboratory very quickly. Another example is different types of dunes that form in an environment that are deprived of sediment. So when there is not enough sediment, like in desert environments, these dunes form like Barkan dunes, as you see here, these crescent-shaped features, which appear in deserts, but also on the surface of Mars and so on. So let me show you, I'm going to show you one. I'm going to skip this and show you the next video. Okay, this one. So this is actually a video we had created which shows the bed evolution And the blue contours are instantaneous vorticity contours. So you begin to see how these features are created on the bed, and you see the shedding of large-scale vortex structures into the flow. Again, this is a fully turbulent, very high-resolution simulation. The paper will just appear in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics. It's just accepted. As it'll turn, you see actually the field of crescent-shaped Barkan dunes that one can observe that very, very similar. I mean, we're able to show that the scaling of these dunes is very similar to what has been observed in nature. We're able to find explanations for physical mechanisms that sustain these dunes to equilibrium and so on. Anyway, that's an indication of the types of simulations that we are able to do now. I'm not going to talk about this. I will come to the end here. So, but I want to highlight this one, which how one now can use these tools to really try to address climate change impacts. Okay. So, a couple of years ago, we were approached by the Minnesota DOT Department of Transportation. This is a 3.5 kilometers reach of the stretch of the Mississippi River. This bridge that goes over the Mississippi is actually a homeland security bridge, very important. They wanted to see what happens if there is a 100-year and a 500-year flooding event, right? So what we did is we put together, we constructed this digital terrain model, getting different types of data, LIDAR data to look at the floodplain, river bathymetry data, water depth for different flood conditions, historic data, the geometries of the bridge piers and so on, and we're able to put together to create this digital terrain model and do simulations of unprecedented resolution, really, of different flooding scenarios. So this is the whole model in place. You can see here, these are simulations of baseline flow conditions. We accompany this. So the flow is coming from here. This is velocity contours at the surface. The bridge piers are here. We went out on boats. We made measurements for this particular baseline flow. The real exciting thing is to be able to create a 100-year flood, for instance. The island is submerged, right? Most importantly, because we have the capability to simulate dunes, you see here, we simulated this flooding condition for 1 month of physical time. And what you see here are dunes, actually. Large red is areas of sediment accumulation. Look at the very complicated scour and refilling dynamics around the bridge piers. You can actually zoom around the foundations right now and see exactly what happens. So now we have tools that you can give engineers, for instance, for a 500-year flood, this is the type of exposure you can expect for your foundations, 500, 100-year, and so on. So these are tools that can really be used to begin to, through virtual environments, really begin to address, assess risk for impacts of megastorms and climate change. And the same thing can be done for flooding in New York City, as we're talking about some collaborations here and so on. The last thing I want to highlight to you is work that we're doing in the area of hydrokinetic energy. We've been working for a long time with a company, Verdant Power, that's developing this tidal array in the East River. So you see here the results of our simulations. This has been funded by DOE and NSF, and now we are talking about a new proposal to DOE that will try to do the same thing, but for a utility scale project in the Sound. So I want to show you the results of, our simulations here. So this is now, we got the East River bathymetry working together with Verdant. Verdant has developed this plan for a 30 turbine array. You see the turbines are in tri-frames, like sets of three that are dropped. They are all mounted in the same base, and they are dropping them at the bottom of the East River. And what they have no way of knowing is how to optimally place those turbines for a particular environment of the East River. And we can actually provide this information. Okay, so what you see here is a particular tide scenario, the flow going this way. Of course, we were doing simulations for different directions. You see a plane that is cutting at the bed. So you don't, this is just a 2D slice, but this is a full 3D unsteady simulation. You can begin the energy deprived wakes. Of course, you need to make sure, for instance, this turbine here is not really extracting much energy because it's too close to this other turbine. So these types of decisions that you can make with these computational tools. Similar thing for wind farms. This is now a site in Minnesota where we can get the terrain and actually computationally really simulate the atmospheric boundary layer interacting with big wind farms in an actual setting. Last but not least is our more recent work, where again I think there are opportunities for collaborations here. This is work funded by the Department of Energy, where we extended the tools now to incorporate ocean waves. We have the ability to do broadband ocean waves interacting with atmospheric turbulence and structures, flow structure interaction. So this is a floating turbine design. This has been designed as a solution to the problem of people being able to see those turbines, right? So they have to go 30 miles off the coast, and they can, if you can make them float there, you can put them way out in the ocean. With funding from the Department of Energy, we developed these computational tools right now that allows us to see, we can incorporate real ocean waves, atmospheric turbulence, and we can get the response of the turbine, we can get actually the power it produces, and try to optimize offshore wind farms and so on. So anyway, so this is I think what I had to tell you. If you have any questions, I'll be able to answer them. Yeah.
Eels, you know, are significantly more slimy than mackerel, for instance. So I'm curious how you incorporated that into your...
No, that has not been incorporated. You're right, there are a lot of biological... I mean, one could do that.
You should incorporate
it. Sorry?
I think that's significant.
It is. You're absolutely right. But again, we have created virtual models of this with clear descriptions of what they are, right? So we were there. I'm not saying that there are no other factors that may be explaining certain hydrodynamic performance, but if you exclude those factors and you really just look at body shape and kinematics, okay? But of course I cannot say that, of course sliminess would affect the, would cause further drag reduction, it could have an effect. It could be incorporated in the models actually, that's an interesting point, because you could incorporate roughness loss that could account for the sliminess. Exactly. Well, it's not as simple, because the problem is, in order to account it correctly, you have to have a very fine resolution of the flow very near. You have to resolve what's called this viscous sublayer. Okay? So it is possible, it is tricky, it requires a lot of computational resources, but we haven't done this. But what we did is, when you take side by side these virtual surrogates of the living things, we were able to draw some conclusions.
I was at a big aquarium last week and I was observing all kinds of animals swimming, ranging from like a fat penguin with silly little wings like this, and they can really zoom through the water,
yeah,
to sort of salmon and then the sharks. And the sharks are so impressive. And I'm just wondering, you know, how important is the tail? Because an eel doesn't really have a tail.
Right.
Where does the forward thrust come from?
Yeah.
It's wiggling along.
So most of the thrust comes from the tail, actually, in this, in at least in shark-like swimming, right? For eel, it just slithers more or less, right? So it is different. It's more of like a piston that is pushing the flow backward, and it's a traveling wave. But for sharks, a tuna, and so on, the tail is extremely important. As a matter of fact, there is my former student Iman, who is now a professor at the University of Buffalo. He has done a lot of recent work looking at the details of the tail. And there is, some shark tails are asymmetric, right? They have one fin is bigger than the other and so on. So there is a lot of interesting implications for hydrodynamics, but the tail is extremely important. That's why you saw that the Strouhal number, which is based essentially on the tail bit frequency and amplitude, is the key parameter in this, because that creates the vortex fields in the wake that ultimately are responsible for the thrust. So it is very, very important. And I think with the same models, you can explore these questions. And in fact, as I said, people are already working on these things. Yes.
Wow. As you said, I have two comments. One is just that it's interesting that in fluid muds, you find eels, but you don't find the other.
In what?
In fluid muds.
Yeah.
Eels are quite common, so that's a high viscosity.
Because this type of kinematics, I mean, you see sperm swims that way, right? Yeah. This is the typical signature kinematics of very low Reynolds number environment.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, So
yeah,
it's very
interesting. Yeah.
The second question I had concerned the bottom boundary in the case of your sand waves. How do you treat the flow of pore fluids through the bottom boundary?
Okay, that, yeah, I know what you mean. So the model that we have here, we have the bottom of the bed, okay? It's kind of the surface that's the interface at the edge of bed load layer. So we have an equation, Exner equation, that essentially tells you, based on the shear stresses that are imparted on the flow and the fluxes of sediment that are going in and out, how this surface changes. So you solve this equation, you use a macroscopic approach here. You don't have a fluidized bed in this approach, you don't have individual particles, you just have an equation for this layer that is the bottom layer, which is, it's a differential, two-dimensional differential equation for the shape of the surface. This has a lot of physics, so it gets the turbulence from the flow, okay, because you're solving it coupled with the flow. This is a fully flow structural interaction. So you start from a flat bed, the turbulent stresses are creating motion on this bed and fluxes that begin to wrinkle the bed, and then it takes over from that. And then you have also an equation for suspended sediment, because sediment either is deposited on this interface or comes into suspension. So you solve an advection diffusion equation for this. It is a model which it is macroscopic in many ways, but it is realistic, because we can do simulations of flooding for a period of 1 month in actually less than the physical time. We can do this in computers, and we can simulate a month of flooding. It could take a week or so to do the simulations that I showed you for the Mississippi River, but this was flooding over a period of 1 month. So, and with a lot of physics that we can. But there are different ways to handle this. There are more sophisticated methods, but they can only do very, very simple problems, and they can stay in a certain range of parameters and flow speeds and so on.
Mary.
Do you work with the Olympic swimmers at all? I mean, some of those pictures of the eels.
Olympic swimmers?
Yeah.
No, I haven't done any work
with
them.
About the
Right, right. No, there, I know some other colleagues that started working in these fields more recently. They have done some work on Olympic swimmers. Yeah.
Well, we don't even have a pool, so.
Yeah, that's right. No, but we don't need a pool. That's the idea.
Yeah.
I have my own pool with my computer.
Have one.
Yeah. Yeah. But you see, this is very interesting. In fact, there has been some more recent work using these types of methods that you can really look at the effects of different strokes. Because the problems there are very difficult, because this is very high Reynolds number flows, okay? And you need very, very high resolution. I think now the resolution is there. We can actually do a pretty good job in that. But personally, I haven't worked. But there are some people that have looked into that, actually using human beings, using a full human anatomy, trying to see how they swim and so on. Yeah.
Any question right here?
Yeah, I had a question about your fish on the stick.
Yes. No, because there's going to be a force on the tether, right? What we were looking is that if the thrust and drag is not balanced, there is a net force. So what that means, if let's say the net force is backwards, the drag force, if you cut the tether at that moment, the fish is swept back, right? If there is a net thrust force and you cut the tether, the fish will accelerate. But there is only one tail bit frequency where if you cut the tether, the fish will keep moving at the speed of the tether. That's when the forces. So essentially, you start from a fish that is you pick the velocity, you start moving the fish, right? The fish begins to move its tail at a given frequency. For that frequency, initially, as you start from zero, you're going to have lots of drag force. You're not going to be able, the tether takes that drag force, and you are able to move it because you have it tethered. Then you apply energy to do this. But as you keep increasing the swimming speed, at some point, as you saw in the results, you get to a point where the tether experiences no force at all. That is when drag balances the thrust. And if you cut the tether, it will keep moving at constant speed. So that's the nice thing about this experiment. You can play with these things and do something that you cannot do it otherwise, right? With the
Fotis, have you done any simulations with very small animals and the influence of seawater viscosity on swimming,
in, let's say, copepods or very small animals?
I didn't talk about it. I have a whole paper in general experimental biology of looking. I will send you this. Joe Katz from Johns Hopkins is a fluid mechanician, but looking at a lot of biological problems. He had developed these very great holographic imaging techniques that you could actually look at the strokes of swimming in copepods. And so we did it very much. I've done the full copepod with the antenna and the legs, and we have identified. We looked at different. We the copepod moves its antenna like this, but there is it does this as it extends, right? So the reverse stroke is very important. And we're able to show computationally why this is happening. So we have all this. Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, I worked on this over 10 years, but now I think I'm always looking for ideas and collaborations to do more, because the codes, in fact, they're much more refined than when we started originally. But we sort of started in this path. Now others have gotten in this. Now I tend to get bored if I work on the same area for a long time. And now I'm dean, so I'm not even supposed to be.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
One more question. So, Fotis, how about the swam group swimming? Then the turbulence kind of...
Okay, so yeah. So there is cooling. We have done things in that too. I didn't. So we have looked at multiple fish swimming in school. Right now, in fact, I have a student still at the University of Minnesota who is really looking at flexible swimmers in the sense that these are flexibles, but you prescribe the flexibility, right? You actually prescribe the motion. What we're trying to do is to develop a model right now where you have an active component of the flexibility and a passive one, right, as a result of the fluid forces. So we're looking at the swimming of multiple flexible flags, for instance. And it turns out that you find a lot of things. But that's an area that some of my more recent work is focused there. I didn't show you some results, but I have quite a bit of results in this area. And you can find interesting results because depending on the distance of the swimmers and the fish that trail can use the wakes of fish that are ahead in constructive ways and amplify their swimming ability and so on. There's a lot of work in this field right now in what causes fish schooling and how fish are able to swim in schools and how they do it and how they're able to turn as a school and so on. So there's primarily in Europe this is happening, but we have done some work in this area as well. And we have with this coach, we have the capability to look at multiple fish and whatever, yeah. But the problem is that one of the reasons that I stopped in my more recent work that I showed you with the fish jumping out of the water is it's always good to find an experimentalist, because I don't like to do simulations that are kind of there, okay? So we did some of these, we're able to explore some questions, but for these things, it's good to find somebody who does experiments so that you have a starting point to formulate these types of simulations.
We still have a faculty member here, Jeanette Yen.
I know Jeanette. So the work with the copepod,
yes,
is a joint NSF project. Jeanette was here?
Yes. Yeah.
Before went to Georgia Tech?
Yes. Yes.
You're kidding me. I didn't know that. So Jeanette and I have collaborated together. We had an NSF project, a collaborative project, one part in Minnesota and another Georgia Tech, that we did this work. So that's okay. It's a small world. See, I know everybody.
We better get down to get pieces before it gets cold.
All right. Thank you.